In today's video, we're looking at the Hungarian Uprising of 1956. There are four essential questions you need to be able to answer by the end of this video. The first is, what happened in Hungary in 1956? The second, who are Matyas Rakosi, Imre Nagy, and Janos Kadar? And what do they do? The third, why do the events in Hungary discourage other Eastern European radicals? And finally, the fourth, how does this event affect our understanding of Khrushchev? So let's look at what people in Eastern Europe thought of Soviet control. So, at first, after World War II, people were very hopeful. They thought that communism could help them recover from the food and product shortages, as well as the poverty caused by the war. However, the reality of Soviet control in Eastern Europe was different, because Eastern Europeans couldn't criticize their governments, or else they would be put into prison. Their newspapers were censored, and they couldn't travel to Western European countries. Also, although Eastern Europe did recover, the factories produced things that the USSR wanted. The wages were lower than in the West, as well as lower than in the USSR, and they still had shortages of coal and food as well as other necessities. So people were quite unhappy. Now let's take a look at what specifically happened in Hungary. From 1949 until 1956, a hardline communist leader called Matyas Rakosi took over control of Hungary, and he was backed by the USSR. People hated his oppressive regime because he did a number of things that they didn't like. For example, Hungarian coal, oil, and wheat were shipped to Russia, even when Hungarians were starving. Also, people were terribly afraid of the secret police, and Hungarians were bitter because they no longer had freedom of speech. The cherry on top was that Hungarians had to pay for Soviet forces to be stationed in Hungary. Matyas Rakosi's nickname was the Bald Butcher, and he used salami tactics to deal with his opponents. Salami tactics basically mean that he divided the opposition up bit by bit. In fact, he imprisoned 387,000 people and killed over 2,000. So therefore, people were very unhappy with his oppressive regime. In February of 1956, Khrushchev gave his secret speech, and a program of de-Stalinization occurred. This gave hope to the people in Eastern Europe. They hoped that Khrushchev would be less restrictive and give them more freedom. As a result, in June of 1956, a group inside the Hungarian Communist Party were set up to begin to oppose Rakosi. Rakosi in turn asked Moscow for help in arresting these 400 or so opponents, but Moscow wouldn't help him. In fact, Moscow ordered Rakosi to retire for health reasons. In July of 1956, a new Hungarian leader was selected by the USSR. His name was Erno Gero, and people disliked him as well. On October 23, 1956, there were huge student demonstrations in Budapest. They pulled down a giant statue of Stalin and used petrol bombs and grenades. As a result, the USSR allowed a new government to be formed under Imre Nagy. Nagy was a lot more liberal, and he proposed the following reforms. 1. Hold free elections in Hungary. 2. Create impartial courts. 3. Withdrawal of the Soviet army. 4. He also wanted Hungary to leave the Warsaw Pact and declare Hungary a neutral in the Cold War. Nagy thought that the USA and the UN would help support this newly independent Hungary. However, in November 4th of 1956, Khrushchev, although he seemed ready to accept some of Nagy's reforms, would not accept Hungary leaving the Warsaw Pact. As a result, Khrushchev sent 200,000 Soviet troops and approximately 6,000 Soviet tanks to Budapest. This began 2 weeks of bitter fighting, in which 2,500 to 3,000 Hungarians were killed. 200,000 Hungarians fled to the west, and 7,000 to 8,000 Russians were killed. The Western powers told the USSR to stop, but they sent no help. Why didn't they send help? Well, 1, they were preoccupied with the Suez Crisis in the Middle East. 2nd reason, they were not willing to risk a war out in the open with the USSR. And 3rd, the USA would send money, but no military support. So it sort of underlined the fact that the USA was interested in containing communism in the countries it was in already, but not freeing countries that were communist. So, by the end of November 1956, Khrushchev put Janos Kadar in place as the new Hungarian leader. Kadar was everything Nagy was not, and he developed a 15-point program. In his 15-point program, he wanted to re-establish communist control in Hungary. He stated that Hungary would remain in the Warsaw Pact, and that he wanted to negotiate the withdrawal of Soviet troops once the fighting was over. The fighting did continue into 1957, but really, by the end of those 2 weeks in November, the fighting was over, and Hungarian people had really no choice but to accept Kadar's new government. So what happened to Nagy? Nagy had sought protection from the Yugoslavian embassy. The Yugoslavian ambassador spoke with Khrushchev, and Khrushchev agreed to let Nagy leave Hungary safely. However, when Nagy left the embassy, he was arrested, accused, and then found guilty of treason in a trial that was overseen by Khrushchev himself. And then, in June of 1958, he was hanged. In fact, following this execution, Khrushchev stated that Nagy's fate was a lesson to the leaders of all socialist countries. So we now see that Khrushchev was not as nice as we probably had hoped he would have been. And how did this affect other Eastern European countries? Since no aid was given to Hungary, and Khrushchev came down so hard on Nagy, other radicals in Eastern Europe were discouraged and afraid. So that was the Hungarian Uprising of 1956. In our next video, we're going to look at the Berlin Wall crisis. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.